Alright, so I've just replaced the blue tape. Now, I'm gonna level the bed, because I haven't done this in quite a while. Okay, so, let's start with this corner. And that is a bit tight. But then, alright, so that's no good. Can't level the bed because there's still a little bit of plastic sticking out from the extruder from the last time I printed. So I'm going to need to clear that by heating up the extruder so I can clean that bit off. So let me just clean off the business end of this extruder. So, I just retracted the filament about 20 millimeters. So I'll let this clear so that I can get rid of all of the old preheated stuff that's still in the extruder. While letting that drain, I will go and slice my part. That's all sliced and ready. Okay, so got that sliced and uploaded. Let me turn off the heater while I do the bed leveling. Get rid of this blobby here. Okay, now let's level the bed. Zero the z-axis. It's a little tight. Since that's my home, I'm gonna move the ZN stop to set that. Let's try that. A little bit higher. Of a gap. A little bit less. What? All right. Too little. Okay, so yeah, so that's the I can feel the resistance, but it's not tight. Now I'm going to move this guy over here. Not bad. Feel resistance, but it's not tight. This here. That may be too little resistance. Raise it by a slight amount. Okay. Better. I think it was pretty level before. I don't think I needed to do anything. Okay, so that bed stayed pretty level. Really did not need to do anything. Alright, so heat up the nozzle now. And then since I retracted so much, I'm gonna have to extrude a bunch until I see that the extrusion starts flowing before we start with the print. So I gotta wait for this to get up to heat up. What's going on here? All right, there we go. I sliced, put on new blue tape, cleaned it off with alcohol, leveled the bed, and then now I'm going to extrude out to the point where extrusion actually pushes out the bottom, right? Because I retracted like 20 millimeters, plus I believe at the end of a run, I have like another 100 millimeters of extrusion or something, or of retraction rather. So in reality, what was flowing out of the tip was what was left in the bottom. I've pulled the filament probably up to, I don't know, maybe here or something. And so I'm gonna need to push filament back down until I see flow. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50. You see it's falling, but when I hit the button, it doesn't push out. There we go. I push, right? 5 millimeters and it pushes out. So now I know that extrusion actually produces an effect. So that's ready to go. Now I hit the print button. So it's not gonna start. I've started the print sequence. What's happening right now is it's waiting for it to get to speed. Now it goes. So it's printing the skirt. You'll notice that the flow isn't quite perfect yet, right? It's not flowing at full rate. Now we've achieved full rate. And that's why I use like 3 or 4 goes of the skirt so that I can achieve full flow. Sticking looks okay. Level looks fine. It's not, bottom layer isn't getting squished down, but there's still good adhesion. Now we start printing. So what am I printing here? I'm printing a frame for my GoPro, the one that's currently taking this video. I got the battery backpack for the GoPro. So the previous frame that I printed, which was for no backpack, doesn't really fit anymore. So I downloaded a design from Thingiverse that is tall enough or wide enough to handle the backpack, and I'm printing it out now. Estimated print time on this originally is 1 hour and 43 minutes from the, based on the data. I find that usually it's fairly accurate. Since the first layer is print slow, the running estimate right now says 9 hours, which is too much. It's not going to take 9 hours. And besides, I only have about 2 hours and 30 minutes or so of battery. So it's not going to last all that time. And you'll notice that since I started the video, it took about 22 minutes to do this. Well, it's been printing for a while. So it took about 20 minutes to do the setup in this case, which included checking the leveling, which it turned out that I didn't even make any adjustments to the level. And while I was waiting for the extruder to drain, I went and sliced, so it does include slicing time and then print time. If I were to print, say, any other time today, I wouldn't need to bother check the leveling again. Based on how this leveling is basically the same as the last time I printed, the last time I printed was about 5 or 6 weeks ago. I'm pretty satisfied that the level doesn't really change too much, despite the wood. I'm lucky that where I live, it's relatively dry. So while we're watching it print here, let me just show you the different parts of my setup here. I've got the PLA here, my yellow PLA spool. And it's sitting on a 3D printed version of the Printrbot Jr. stand. This is the wood stand that you can buy, and then there's a 3D printed version of it. That's down here. This one is the modified version that's been modified to be a little bit wider so that it'll fit the Matter Hacker's spool. It's got 4 bearings here the spool is sitting on, right? And these 4 bearings are the ones that came from the original, the laser cut wood version of the Printrbot Jr. spool holder. I've got this feeding into this guy here, which is the SeeMeCNC EZStruder. Personally, I had a lot of problems with the built-in or with the original Printrbot Jr., the geared extruder. I had problems where the extruder jammed,
and it backed up, or basically got stuck somewhere in here, and then it formed a huge knot here in the back where it was pushing the cold extruder against some blockage. Created a huge problem for me, particularly in the Bowden setup. And so I replaced that with the EZStruder, which is a direct drive extruder. And the direct drive has had, I've had plenty of torque with the built-in motors that come with the Kaizen motors that come with the current Printrbot kit. So this is a direct drive, got in a Bowden setup here. I haven't had any torque problems with this. This is then set up with the Bowden setup. The new fit adapters that come from SeeMeCNC, that's what I'm using on both ends here. Since this is the EZStruder from SeeMeCNC, these are designed to fit, so this just screws in, metal on metal. Then there's the PTFE tube. This then comes into the Bowden adapter that is on Thingiverse for the Printrbot Jr. Now, the original Bowden adapter design on Thingiverse is designed for a different NewFit adapter that is that has a screw thread that is bigger than the ones from SeeMeCNC. So I took the original STL files and put them into Tinkercad. And just using additive modeling, I filled in the hole so the hole was the right size to kind of thread this in. And then I used some hot glue to make sure that it was fully immobilized. What this thing is sitting on here, right, is a little adapter. I don't know if you can see it clearly, but if you go to Thingiverse and look for a Printrbot Jr. Bowden kind of motor mount, this thing here is a design of is a object of my own design here that is designed to just hold in by tension the z-axis sandwich, or the z-y-axis sandwich here. And then I've got the Kaizen motor zip tied to this. And so this whole thing lifts, there's plenty of torque on this for the threaded rod here to raise this whole assembly without issue and do the Bowden. Another interesting thing is the retraction settings. I have very aggressive retraction settings set here. It turns out that you can retract really fast, 300 millimeters per second. So I have quite aggressive retraction here based upon experimentation done I forget his name, for that guy who did the recent DeltaBot on Kickstarter, but he discovered that you can do very aggressive retraction with the EZStruder, so I have that set. You might hear it if I stop talking at the next layer when it does retraction, where you can hear it retract really quickly. Yep, did you hear that? Kind of the retraction, pull back, push forward, 300 millimeters per second. I haven't had any problem with any jamming from that speed. I did have to change some of the firmware limits. I believe it won't go that fast by default. There's a firmware setting that is originally limits it to 100. You don't need to actually recompile firmware to this for this. And I can't get the source code for the Printrbot Jr. firmware anyway, but you can change the stored firmware setting with G-code commands, so there's no reason to recompile firmware anyway. This is one of the late model Printrbot Juniors. It comes with a fan by default, so this is just the stock fan that came with my kit, and I have a sheet of acrylic here that I bought from Remnants for like $5 from Orchard Supply Hardware. And I've got it clipped down with like two binder clips. And this has kept the bed really, really level. Two other things that you might not be able to see clearly, I've got okay, anyway. So I've got belt tensioners here. I've got one model belt tensioner here and another one over here. This is the one that can do it on Thingiverse that is doable with one screw and a bunch of zip ties. It's not that good. I don't like it that much because this is zip tie clamp mechanism. It's not that tight. It's hard to get the belt really tight. It's this guy here that requires a lot more screws, which I guess you can't really see because it's blocked by the spool. This guy is a lot better. I do have quite a lot of different upgrades here that you might be able to see. First, the belts here. These are replaced with the GT2 metric belts. And that means that also the pulleys right here and the pulley underneath the X-axis here, those are also replaced with the 16-tooth pulleys. That's a relatively cheap upgrade. These pulleys are like, you know, $2 or $3. The belt is like also, you know, maybe $4 for enough for 2 or 3 printer bots. I also have a metric rod upgrade. So this here is like an M6 metric rod. So that one's replaced. And then I also replace the weird sandwich thing that it comes with a standard coupler here, a flexible one. You might see down here it's got these ridges here, and that basically means that it can flex, because we know that this rod isn't perfectly straight. The whole thing is not designed to be straight here. Sitting behind here, which you also can't see, is a different nut holder to fit the M6 threaded rod, and this is the design on that's available on Thingiverse. That is,
do I have one? The scrap pieces that I can show you. I did print out more than one.
The ironic things about 3D printing in general is that I've got multiple versions of each of these that are slightly off size. They look similar, but you know, they didn't actually fit once I printed them, since there's a lot of variability in the plastic. But that's the version that has the two nuts with the spring in the middle to reduce the backlash, and is printed big and small enough that the nuts will stop rotating so that this rotation mechanism still works, but big enough that there is some play. Again, because you don't want this rod to be super stiff in the housing, because this rod is not guaranteed to be straight. It's almost guaranteed not to be straight. So straightness is provided by these two rods here, and this just provides the motion. And you want this to be movable, right? You want this to be able to sway a bit, so that any imperfections in the screw don't cause any kind of weird motion in the raising and lowering of this. And I've printed a couple of quite long items, and haven't seen any kind of Z-axis waviness. So that mechanism, or that design decision, on the PrinterBot seems to be sound. And when doing upgrades, whether it's the nut upgrade, the holder upgrade here, the Z-axis nut upgrade here, or the replacement of the weird sandwich thing, the sandwich tubing thing that comes with it, to a real aluminum coupler here, you want to retain those design characteristics. So right, this is a flex coupler, so that it flexes, and that retains the kind of the slight play that is allowable in the original sandwich. And then this guy also has some play available. All of those are important. You don't want to do any weird things that tie these things together. And that's it for the upgrades. I do notice that if you want to take a look, this is a prototype version. It's sized slightly off. So look, this is the belt tensioner I have back here. All right, basically the screws go in here and then you screw them, and that pulls this guy back, tensions the belt, goes in here. Printing this thing there was a bunch of trial and error, both in making sure that these ended up printing at the right size given the variations in plastic shrink, and these printed the right way for the nuts that I had, and that this gap was also the right width to fit the belt. I found that printed stock, this gap here was too narrow for me to get the belt in. I had to print it a little bit wider. And then with the cross screw here, you can actually get this thing cinched down really, really tight on the belt. And so there's everything here is, all the action here is done with screws. There's no need to use elbow grease to get this thing tight. Unlike this guy down here, where it took tremendous amount of elbow grease to pull these two zip ties tight. And even then, the leverage you get from tightening this screw here will exceed the ability for these hand-tightened zip ties to hold the belt in. So there is a maximum tightness that you can achieve that you can't, you know, even with pliers, I could not get these so tight that I couldn't overcome the clamping force through tightening this thing. In either case, these belts are tight enough. I haven't had any issues with calibrations. So both with the metric rod and the belts, I can have the calibration set to the ideal calibrations based upon the specifications of the belt and the rod, and those work fine, right? My calibration cubes, like this guy here, come out, you know, 5 millimeters per step, 10 millimeters, or rather, whatever, 50 millimeters, 25 millimeters total, in all three axes. So calibration on this with the metric upgrades is really, really good. Once I've got everything tightened up, speed is also quite good. I've actually had problems where the edges don't look good if I run it too slow. And so there's a certain sweet spot I found in terms of speed, especially for these items that have a lot of like flat edges. There's a sweet spot in you want to be a certain speed. You don't want to go too slow for some of these. So now we will just let it print. Thank you. All right, so we've printed for a while. And yes, sorry for narrating here because it means that you're going to miss this if you aren't watching it one-to-one. And who's going to watch this at one-to-one because it's incredibly boring. But you'll notice that there's some overhangs here, right? And the overhangs have printed without support because one of the nifty things about our slicing algorithms that it can figure out that we don't need support if the angle is not too extreme. And in this design, the angle is not too extreme, right? It's about 45 degrees, right? You'll see that there's a 45 degree overhang here, and it's printed out about right, right? It's 45 degrees, stuck out. If I look closely, and of course you can't see this angle because you're on a tripod, but I'll show this to you at the end. The overhang is actually quite clean. We've got this 45 degree overhang here. It's going to print out, and this is the loop where the little GoPro clamp is going into. But this is quite impressive, right? It means that we can design overhangs without support into the system. We can print it out at relatively high speed. You see my head speed is moving fairly fast, 60 or so millimeters per second, maybe a little more, I can't remember. And we can achieve decent quality overhangs, decent quality wall quality as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so after that delay, it looks like we are done. So now I've got to lift this guy off. And this is a bit of the tricky part. So the spatula thing I got for like $5 on Amazon is really good, because this here is very, very thin. And thin is good because it helps me slide under here and free the piece easily. Couple of strategic points. And then it's not a disaster if you tear the tape. If I didn't tear the tape, I could keep using it, because you don't need to put down a fresh layer every time. But if I end up tearing it, it's not a disaster. Let's see if I can There we go. And there it is. The piece has come off. And so if we take a look at this guy, right, what's really interesting is the way that this overhang is designed, right? You notice that how it's not symmetric. So whoever designed this piece must have deliberately designed this overhang to be not too extreme, right? Because the top part here is flat. And there's no way you could have a flat overhang, right? If this piece here were symmetric and they tried to do this flat part here, and do the same thing at the bottom, that totally wouldn't work. They deliberately went up at a 45-degree angle so they could build the overhang. And then on coming back, you know, you don't have such a problem. So you can come back at whatever angle you want. So here's the printout. No, pretty good.